Ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen, let me tell ya, and ladies. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have a little bit of Jamiroquai in my background and a bunch of others. I want to go ahead and tell you that you can grab a cup of water and you can take both the red pill and the blue pill. And you can continue to take both the red pill and the blue pill continuously because it is insanity, ladies and gentlemen. Let me go ahead and explain something to you that no one has taken the time to give you the complete map. Now, we're gonna be traveling through time. So if you're into sci-fi, we're gonna take a trip back in time. We're gonna take a trip back into the recent past, and we're gonna take a trip into the here and now to let you guys know what's truly going on. The first thing we're gonna do, sorry, I have to open up a Word document. I need to let you guys know, those of you who are of interest, who have mortgages that you're dealing with, there is something known as a QWR. Yes, 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 the moratorium is over, but you still have the right to do a QWR. Well, they say you have to do it in... No, 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 no. You're bringing up a completely different issue. So I'm going to explain it briefly. I've been up since, 5:30 this morning? It is 9:11. And, yes, I'm on fumes. Yeah, the video you did right today, you had so much energy, and then you have no energy. Yeah, all my energy is gone. Plus, I had a consult earlier this morning, and after the consult, I did that video, took about 2 hours, and then after that, I had to sit up there and finish the arbitration, and that's finally done. 9 days for one arbitration, ladies and gentlemen. Now, when I say 9 days for one arbitration, please understand it took 7 days to put the arbitration together, 2 days to sit up there and go through the... That's 8:39. Sorry, I got to turn my lighting up a little bit. 8:39. I got to make sure all of the information is in here, or I'm going to have to redo the one that I put online. So y'all just going to have to wait a minute, okay? Got to make sure I give y'all the latest one, not the oldest one, but the latest one. So hold on, got to check some things. No, this is not the latest one. Whew, the latest one has September. I think this might be it. Oh, mommy, I think that might be it. So the one I just opened is the one I put online. I'm going to have to take that one down because that's the incorrect one. So we got some things to talk about. Ladies and gentlemen, there are some things in the law that many of you may not be aware of. You had an idea, but you didn't know where it was, how it was, how you could get there, why you could get there. And so what's going to happen is we're going to go ahead and get you where you need to go. Okay? You just got to bear with me. Okay? Because we're going to give you the bare bones, okay? Just the bare bones. Going to get you right to the facts. Just the facts, ma'am. The F-A-X, ma'am. Okay? So I just need you guys to bear with me just for a moment so that I can... I have to remove an item. No, you know what? I don't have to remove the island. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Loki, and he's talking about what he believes. And I believe he believes. And as long as he believes, I believe. You know what I'm saying? Come on, Loki. See? September 1st. 2021, this is the right one. You got the right one, baby. Okay? I believe. You know what? I didn't save it when I did that. That's the thing. But the other one was the outdated one. So, we... Uh-oh. I didn't know I was opening up this many. Uh-oh. I opened up too many. So, let me pause you guys for just a second, okay? We'll be back with Loki. Hey, ladies and gentlemen. The young man is right. It's necessary that we believe. And so we're going to believe. I'm going to let that be in the background. There's no reason for that to be in the foreground, so it's going to be in the background. I want you all to pay attention. The new document is not on SAA's website. Eventually it will be on SAA's website, but for the time being, time is everything. For the time being, this document is here at SACOM. So what's happening, you all need to understand, is currently the document that's up there, and nobody knew it was up there because I haven't done a video talking about it being up there, but there is a document on SATCOM that is not the correct document, doesn't have the completed amendment. I haven't had time to perfect it, but I had time to put the right stuff in it. You got the right one, baby. I had time to put the right stuff. Man, you got the right stuff. Anyway, I had time to put the right stuff in the document. Okay? And because I had time to put the right stuff in the document, we're going to put it in the very first document, A Legal Understanding. That's where it's going to be. So that if you are looking for the document, that's where you're going to find it. If you don't find it there, then you ain't going to find it nowhere. You feel me? Because if you don't feel me, y'all better give Muhammad back his title. Because he said if Muhammad wants his title back, y'all better give it to him. Okay, that document is up. Well, sorry, it ain't up yet. What we're going to do is we're going to overwrite. And it's uploading. See, right there, uploading. So it should be finished in a minute. It will give us a chime that it is up. If it doesn't have September 1st in the document, then it is not the correct one. The older ones, they're okay. You can still use those. What happens is, ladies and gentlemen, many people did not understand the document. I am sorry that that is the case. Okay, honestly, I am sorry that many people did not understand that document. Because that document, I told you, the greatest thing, until I did the criminal complaints, this document was everything. And now it's even more. Now, what do you mean by it's even more? We're going to pause my homie boy, Low-Key. Hey, Low, give me a second, all right, bro? Ladies and gentlemen, Low-Key from the Great Britain environment. Yes, he's a rapper from Great Britain. Low-Key. And I think he is Low-Key. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, the first thing we need to do is we're going to explain the document to you. How do we do that? Well, the first thing is we need to make sure you understand that those are two very big words. What words? The two very big words. Who talked about two very big words? Donald Trump. You don't remember Donald Trump telling y'all that those were two very big words? I remember it. I remember it like it was yesterday. You know what? Not only do... Sorry, there was a bug on my laptop and I had to get rid of him. Not only do I remember... That was just the chime letting us know that the document had been uploaded. Not only do I remember Donald Trump saying those words in the exact format that I just talked about, two very big words. But he did more than say those are two very big words. Look, I am officially declaring a national emergency. Two very big words. That was Donald Trump, ladies and gentlemen. Now, guess what Vanity Fair said? The 12 most insane moments from Donald Trump's national emergency press conference. 12 most insane moments. Because they knew what he was talking about, ladies and gentlemen. They just couldn't tell the public what he was talking about. Ladies and gentlemen, most of you guys don't understand, so we're going to try to explain it to you. So what I've done is in advance, I pulled up things like PDFs, and I just got to make sure all of these windows that I had already gone to, because I restarted the computer. So I just got to make sure every place that I've been is going to be ready for me to show to you. Then reload, okay, so that you can see what I can see. Because the whole purpose of me doing all of this was so that you could have the exact same information. Why is those two very big words? Because he said the words national emergency. If you go back to the act of October 6, 1917, that's right, I said October 6th, 1917. Let me do this for a second. And... yeah, I think we can do that. And then let me do this for a second. See, what I did is I've already downloaded the documents. And the only thing I have to do is open the documents. Open, open, open. What I have we're going to do the open with stuff. Oh, you don't want me to do it that way. It don't want me to open them all up at the same time, y'all. I apologize. It says, no, you're going to open them one at a time. So we're going to open them one at a time. All right. The documents that I'm opening up, ladies and gentlemen, in the PDF are the actual statutes at large. As I showed you in a video yesterday, the gentleman used the, what was that junk called? And I'll upload the statutes at large tomorrow. Okay, it won't be tonight, it'll be in the same folder. Different statutes at large will be the 1917 Act, the 1866 Civil Rights Act, the March 9, 1933 Act, and there's one more, and I'm not drawing a blank for what the other act was, but it was another act that was essential for what's going on now. Okay, so I downloaded, and it's more acts in there than those. In other words, I downloaded the whole section. Okay, so it's not just one act. So let's see. That's 1925, the Federal Arbitration Act. That was the last one. So I downloaded these three acts. This is the one from 1919, 1917 to 1919. This is the Trading with the Enemies Act. It's in this document. Let's see if we can do a word search, because that's where I was going anyway. So let's see if we can do a word search. We, NATIONAL, EMENERGENCY. See, even when I'm tired, I can spell a little bit. I don't think we're going to find it because of the type of document this is. Because this is a, it's a image and not a OCR. Okay? So because it's not OCR, we're probably not going to find it. So what I got to do is I got to do this. If it lets me, because it's not letting me scroll down with that, I need to see the top of the document so I can see what day. So this is 1917. This is the Trading with the Enemies Act. And we're gonna go to, we need October. And I don't know what month that was. That's July. We still gotta go July. We got a ways to go because that's July. You know, October's like 85 months from July. So we gonna get there. Y'all gonna see me when you get there too. I'll see you when you get there. Okay. Give me a second, ladies and gentlemen. You know what I should do? I'm gonna put you guys on pause while I find that. So 1 second, if you don't mind, I'll be right. Oh my Lord, it wasn't easy, y'all, but I found it. See, October 6, 1917. This is the end of the Trading with the Enemies Act. Now we gotta go to the beginning, okay? So here we're gonna go to the beginning. Now we gotta go to the very, oh, that's October 5th. That's what we need. We need the very beginning. Okay, let's open this up. Now, House Representative Secretary hereby authorized to acquire and purchase by blah blah blah. We don't care about that. That's not what we're looking for, Chief. Hold on, I gotta get this out of the way. So you know what? Get out of the way. Now, hold on. Let's see if we can find it. Secretary of the Navy, don't care about them people. Approve October 6, 1917. We might not be able to find it, y'all. Consent to Congress, the Coke Railroad, October 6, 1917. That's another October 6. Wait a minute. Representative, the following sums are appropriated out of the money of the Treasury, not otherwise appropriated, to supply urgent deficiencies and appropriations for fiscal year ending in June 13, 1918 of the prior 50. What? I don't think this is it, y'all. You see, it says Interstate Commerce Commission. That's not what we're looking for. So where is the October 6, 1917 at? Because that's the Trading with the Enemy Act. And it's supposed to say certain words, and I don't see them words. See, it don't say nothing about the president. It's all about the secretary. See, that's October 5th. So something is wrong here. October 6th ain't here, y'all. Now, why is October 6th missing? And it's definitely not a House joint resolution. See, that's October 5th. It is the October 6th. 1917 Act. Okay, and I am looking, And what I don't see, hold on, no bank shall receive or have in circulation. So let's see if they did October 5th. June 3rd, reserve statute, revised statute 50, blah, blah, blah. The act of March 14th, 1900, provided that no national bank association shall have the passage of this act, shall after the passage of this act be entitled to receive from the controller the currency, or to issue or reissue or place circulation more than one-third the amount of its circulating notes of a denomination of $5, be it, and it is hereby repealed. Really? Huh. They repealed the $5 Act, ladies and gentlemen. Now, please understand, this is not the first time they did this, and I want you guys to pay attention to what's going on here. In place of circulation notes in denomination of 1, 2, 5, 10, 20, 50, and hundreds in such proportions as to each of the said denominations as the bank may elect. And it says, however, no bank shall receive or have in circulation in one time more than $25,000 in notes in denominations of ones or twos. Ladies and gentlemen, please understand, it says denomination. What they did not do is give them a value. They just gave them a denomination. That's the first thing you need to understand when you are looking at bills. Ones, fives, tens, the only thing we do in our minds is we say, well, 5 is greater than 10, and 50 is greater than 10, but they're all equal. Don't believe me? Just type in equal power for every dollar, because the dollars all have the same value. That's why the Treasury said that the notes have no value for themselves. Why? Because they're not backed by anything. Where are they going to get value from? Okay, the October 6, 1917 Act is not here, as you all can see. Now, I did not expect that. I honestly did not expect the October 6, 1917 Act not to be in these congressional laws. Okay, October 6, 1917, the act is not very long, but it's long enough to help you realize out of the money of the Treasury fiscal year, it has interstate commerce, emergency shipping fund, but the very portion of this, the very first portion of this act is the president. It's not about all of this right here. Okay, now this is very extensive. This goes through all of the departments. Appropriating monies, so this is the spending appropriations bill. Okay, this is all they're doing is talking about the monies they're giving to all of the different locations, Department of the Treasury, Office of the Secretary. Okay, that's all this is talking about, but it's not talking about the Trading with the Enemies Act. So I apologize, ladies and gentlemen, because I really did think that they would have the Trading with the Enemies Act here on October 6th, because right after we get past all of this junk, the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, and Treasury is authorized during the issuance of, during the continuance of the war with Germany. Okay, acts, and that's not there. And Cape Charles Quarantine Station. Yeah, the United States did that quarantine junk back then too. Just pay attention, y'all. And I don't know. I'm going to keep going till I get to, oh, Washington Asylum. Really? Yeah, they even appropriated money for that. The War Department. Oh, yes, I've heard about the War Department. That's where you can buy war. Yeah, you can go in and pick the size of the war you want. That's the War Department. That's what they do. So, yeah, department store. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, what I cannot find, and I'm not happy, is what we were looking for. And that's the Trading with the Enemies Act, because I wanted you to see the beginning of the words of the Trading with the Enemies Act, and I don't have time to look for it. The beginning words of the Trading with the Enemies Act is the same as the words for the March 9, 1933 Act. So what I'm going to, this is part of what the Trading with the Enemies Act says. The president, during the present emergency, is authorized through the head of any department of government to sell any war materials used in the construction of airplane, blah blah blah. So they continue to announce emergencies, but the Treating with the Enemies Act is the one that actually said during a time of war or any other national emergency. So Donald Trump, a lot of people want to accuse Donald Trump of being stupid, and he was stupid, you know, but he's not a stupid person. Donald Trump knew exactly what he was doing. And I'll show you in just a moment. But what I'm upset about is that I'm not able to find out during any time of war or national emergency. That's why Donald Trump said that, because as I've explained years ago, whenever you hear the term national emergency, they're enacting or invoking the Treating with the Enemies Act. Now, I'm not the only one who knows this. I'm not the only one who knows this. I'm going to show you other people are aware of this as well. But the fact is, I am looking, and you know what? I believe that all of that is included with the Treating with the Enemies Act, and we only have a portion of it. That is the problem. Ladies and gentlemen, I think I am looking at the Treating with the Enemies Act. I'm thinking that this is exactly what the Treating with the Enemies Act did. So, my bad. I believe I am looking at the Treating with the Enemies Act. I'm believing that we're only looking at portions of it because the statutes at large is the law, quote unquote. Sorry, I just almost lost my tongue saying that one. Statutes at large are the so-called law that are enacted by Congress. Do not go by the code, go by the statutes at large, ladies and gentlemen. The code and the statutes at large do not equal. I've already done the video showing you how many mistakes there are in the code and how it doesn't match up with the statutes at large. And the very fact that it doesn't, then you cannot use the code. You cannot rely on the code. That's why you will see me starting to say the words positive law title. Okay? Because that's what it is, positive law title. Now, okay, they're even taking in public buildings and grounds. I believe this is the so-called War Powers Act, ladies and gentlemen, because that's all it's talking about. And it's talking about emergency fund, Bureau of Navigation, Bureau of Ordnance. Yes, I believe, ladies and gentlemen, this is when we became a military government. Not in 1933, like many of us suspect, but when they enacted the Treating with the Enemies Act. That 1933 was a furtherance of that act. Because if you notice, all this is talking about, this whole thing, is talking about military. And look, we're still going. Okay? Ever since I brought you guys back on, we're going. And this is the Postal Service. Out of the Postal Service revenues, the Office of the Postmaster General. Okay, they are talking about everything, and this was during a time of war. Okay, I think it's just about to end because I've already been through this when I was going upwards. You were going upwards? Yeah, I was going upward bound, like them puppies. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I do apologize. I did not. Wait, hold on. I just saw a date. One more. Oh, no. Okay, first Monday in December 1918. Okay, so that's not the date we're looking for, Chief. You're gonna actually see a January 1918 date somewhere real close, and that will let us know the extent of this Traitors Act. It's a shame they made the people enemies, enemies of the state, so to speak. All right, let's go. Using my finger now. Let's see. Still no date. Like I said, it was all about this act, and it was a war times quote unquote act. And because it was an act enacted during war times, they were taking care of everything. Because guess what? You can't make a military government without atoning and assigning and acknowledging all of the different aspects of all the different areas you got to take care of. So I am still going. There we go. This is the end of that portion of the act. Okay? There you go. Now, being enacted by the House, Senate, Legislature privileges, June, blah, 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 be hereby, blah, 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 and Senate, second 1899. Okay, March 2nd, 1899. What is 1899 doing here? Oh, because it was approved 1899. Nobody's worried about no 1899. Secretary of War is hereby authorized to permit under regulations as he may prescribe any officer enlisted, blah, blah, blah. Now, I believe the Secretary of War is the Secretary of Defense. Ladies and gentlemen, all I can tell you is I'm looking for the Trading with the Enemies Act. When the United States is at war, it shall be unlawful to manufacture, distribute, store, or use, or possess powder, explosives, and blasting, blah, blah, blah. Again, this is a wartime, and that's all they were focused on in that year. But I don't see where national emergency, and that's what I'm looking for. And I, what I was suspecting is, like on March 9th, the primary thing that they worked on was the March 9th, 1933 Act. I was thinking that that was the primary thing that they worked on here. But it turns out everything was about war. And they were setting up their military government. Let's see, whether native-born or naturalized citizens of the United States of America. If a naturalized citizen, the date and place of naturalization, desiring to manufacture, sell, or export, blah, blah, blah. So that's their registration if they wanted to sell any ordinances. So, sorry. I thought that we would be able to get to what I was trying to get to, and I see that it ain't that way. That's bridge construction. Okay, Naval Service, Postmaster General, Navy B. Nope, that's not it either. I just need y'all to see what I go through for y'all. For y'all, not for me. Okay. Here's another one. During the continuance of the present war with Germany and until the discharge of his service. So, the United States of America Current General Assembly. And not that one. Public buildings, nope, and nope. Let's see, after the United States shipping abroad, nope, nope, that's not it either. Let's see, representatives consent, nope, still October 6th. This is a whole lot of October 6th, ladies and gentlemen. They were doing a whole lot of military stuff on October 6th. I did not know about this before, honestly. I knew that, see, in the time of war or during the existence of an emergency, in the time of war or during the existence of an emergency, however, you saw that, and this is what the Department of Defense, this is what the Defense Secretary, however, not worried about that one, because the one with the president literally uses the phrase national emergency. And that's where the word is first spoken. That's where it is first applied. That's why they have the National Emergencies Act of 1977, which actually was enacted in 1976, but shh, don't tell nobody. Okay. Let's see. Successful in danger. United States is at war. The publication of an invention by the granting of a patent might be in the opinion of who cares. And let's see. Nope, that's not it either. I just want you to know what I go through, ladies and gentlemen, just to find stuff for you guys, because that's the whole, wait, hold on. Clause 3 of Section 24 of the Judicial Code is hereby amended to read as follows. Of all civil causes of admiralty and maritime jurisdiction, saving the suitors, in all cases, the right of a common law remedy where the common law is competent to give it, and to claimants' rights and remedies under the workmen's compensation laws of any state, of all seizures of land and water not within admiralty and maritime jurisdiction, of all prizes brought into the United States, and all proceedings for the condemnation of property taken as prize. Ladies and gentlemen, apparently, they say common law does not exist. We just read where it does. Now, this is the Act of October 6, 1917, and this shall be known I don't know what they're calling the act. I figure it says an act to amend section 24 and 256 of the Judicial Code. So I would call it the act to amend the Judicial Code relating to jurisdiction of the district court so as to save the complainants the rights and remedies under workman's compensation laws of any state. Workman's compensation is at common law. Uh-oh, I guess y'all didn't know that, huh? You just got to check to see if it's been repealed. Well, no, because statutes at large don't get repealed that way. Statutes at large don't get repealed the way a statute gets repealed. Excuse me, one of those little stupid codes get repealed. Doesn't work the same way. Now, this is something that affects El Paso, Texas, and I'm gonna have to do another video because look how long it took me just to find this, and I'm still not there. This is still October 6th, ladies and gentlemen. These were some busy Biebers. Biebers, that's what I said, Biebers, like Justin Biebers. These were some busy Biebers, okay? And still, nothing about the president declaring a national emergency. During the present emergency, the president be, and he is hereby authorized to organize provisionally the field artillery and infantry, blah, blah, blah. Nope. Authorized to establish the Bureau of War Risk Insurance. Look, they were everything war. So I believe this was the military footing for setting up the military government that we now have today. We see that they did not hold any. This is still the same day. Look at how much these fools enacted in one day. That's your government at work for you, ladies and gentlemen. Taking away all kind of rights, making the military as powerful as it did. They pumped so much money in the military. Hey, you know the term child includes illegitimate child? A child legally adopted more than 6 months before the enactment of the Amendatory Act? Uh-oh. I don't know if any of this will help people, but we will put this on the site because some of it might actually deal with, pay attention, ladies and gentlemen, birth certificates, because we pulled up the majority of them. We didn't pull up everything. Didn't pull up everything, because everything ain't necessary. Don't need to have everything. You just need to have most of everything. Would you stop? I'm not doing anything, ladies and gentlemen. It's doing it. And it's getting on my nerves. Okay, we're still at October 6th, but the fact is, because it did that, I don't know where I was. And I want to get back to where we was. Okay, see that's section 300 and something, so it took us quite a ways away, so I'm not going to be able to find that this way. And because this article 3, compensation for disability, maximum monthly allotment, and where are we at? Monthly family allowance and grandchild. This is still the children's section. There's a whole lot here. I don't know what it's talking about. I really don't, because many of this I did not know was even there. Okay. And I do know we're still at October 6. Okay, so let me get past that. And let's get past this. And this is going to be the last one. Then I'm going to go ahead and show you what I'm talking about. Was going to do another video, but there's no reason to because many of you who are watching this are probably learning something new, the same as I am. And I promise you, I know we're still at October 6, and that's section 405. Section 8 of the Act, entitled An Act, authorized the President to increase temporary military establishments of the to increase temporarily the military establishment of the United States. Like I told you, this is the so-called, as they called it. We didn't call it that. They called it the War Powers Act. Here it is right here, ladies and gentlemen. I told you, look, I don't make this stuff up. This is just the way it is. I told you that was the last one I was going to cover. And then we were going to go on and I was going to show you what I was talking about. Well, guess what? Here is the Trading with the Enemies Act. So it is here. Be it enacted in the Senate and House of Representatives of the United States of America and Congress assembled. When I told you that this was the martial law, they were doing nothing but military acts, setting up a military government. Go back, you're going to have it on a site. You're going to have it on a site. It's going to be, I think it's 1917 to 1919 is this particular document. And wait, hold on. Let's see. What is the name of it? Session. No, God, I'm going to have to rename it, ladies and gentlemen, because but I'll do the act of, I'll do statutes at large 1916 and 1919. That's what I'll do. I'll just put the dates so that way you'll know. Trading with the Enemies Act, an act to define, regulate, and punish trading with the enemy and for other purposes. We're going to focus on the other purposes, perpetrators' purposes, okay? Being enacted by the Senate and the House of Representatives of the United States of America in Congress assembled, that this act shall be known as the Trading with the Enemy Act. That the word enemy, as used herein, shall be deemed to mean, for the purposes of such trading and of this act, an individual, partnership, or other body of individuals, or any nationality, including United States, resident within the territory, including those occupied by military and naval forces of any nation, including the United States, with which the United States is at war, including the citizens of the United States, or a resident outside the United States and doing business within such territories of the United States, and any corporation incorporated within such territories, including the United States, of any nation with which the United States is at war with the people who are named enemies of the state, or incorporated within any country other than the United States doing business within such territory, the government of any nation with which the United States is at war, or political or municipal subdivisions thereof, or any officer, official, agent, or agency thereof, such other individuals or bodies or class of individuals as may be native citizens or subject to or of any nation with which the United States is at war other than citizens of the United States. Other than citizens of the United States. So I guess that will satisfy a lot of people that citizens of the United States, according to this, are not enemies of the United States. Right here it says, other than citizens of the United States, wherever resident or wherever doing business as the president, if he shall find the safety of the United States or the successful prosecution of the war shall so require, may by proclamation, include within the term enemy. So, ladies and gentlemen, the president gets to include individuals as an enemy. Enemy combatant, shh. Enemy combatant, shh. You remember that enemy combatant? Shh. They said they were enemy combatants. Shh. I didn't say it, ladies and gentlemen. They are using the law. Did you know why they were calling them enemy combatants? Anyway, the word ally of the enemy, as used herein, shall be deemed to mean any individual, partnership, individual, blah, 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 blah. We don't need to know the ally of the enemy. What I want to do is get to the other part. Let's see, person shall include, we know what person mean, the United States mean any land or water, continental or insular, to any within the jurisdiction of the United States, or occupied by the military, the word beginning of the war, choose herein, shall be deemed to mean midnight ending the day in which Congress has declared or shall declare war, or the existence of a state of war, the words end of the war, as used herein, shall be deemed to mean the date of proclamation of exchange of ratifications of the treaty of peace, unless the president shall by proclamation declare a prior date in which to cease the date so proclaimed shall be deemed to be the end of the war. Have you heard that about Iraq? That they declared the end of the war. Within the meaning of this act, The word banks and banks as used herein shall be deemed to mean and include national banks, state banks, trust companies, or other banks or banking associations doing business under the laws of the United States or of any state of the United States. The word trade used herein, pay, draw, enter, buy, sell. Uh-oh, nobody will be able to buy or sell without that mark, huh? Buy or sell, loan or extend credit, trade in, deal with, exchange, transmit, transfer, assign, otherwise dispose of, or receive any form of property. Ladies and gentlemen, please understand that if you're going to stand on your square, you're going to need to go over this act to see how it applies to you, to have any form of business or commercial communication or intercourse with. It shall be unlawful for any person of the United States except licensed by the president granting to such a person or to the enemy or ally of the enemy as provided in this act to trade or attempt to trade either directly or indirectly with, to, or from, or for, or on account of, or behalf of, or for the benefit of, you see how technical they trying to get, any other person. With knowledge of reasonable cause and belief that such other person is an enemy, an ally of the enemy, or is conducting or taking part in such trade, directly or indirectly, for or on account of, or behalf of, or for the benefit of, blah, blah, blah. Any such person, though, any person other than a person in the service of the United States government, don't care about that. I am looking for the other part. No, this is still the ally with the enemy. Whoever during the present war, president shall deem to be a public safety demands, shall deem that the public safety demands, he may cause to be censored under such rules and regulations as he may from time to time establish, communicate by mail, cable, or radio, or other means transmitting passage between the United States and a foreign country. No, United States bound, blah, blah, for enemy, ally, enemy, insurance. Nope, don't care about that. Somebody might care about it, but that's not what we're here for. Like I said, this was the reason. We're going to go down that rabbit hole, okay? We're going to go down the rabbit hole. So, told y'all, that's where we're headed. For a period of 30 days after the passage of this act, further pending war risk insurance. Hey, you guys ever got war risk insurance? War risk? I don't know about no war risk. Okay, anyway. Okay, not there. If no license is applied for within 30 days after the passage of this act, or for a license shall be refused to any enemy or ally of an enemy, whether insurance or reinsurance company or other person making application, or if any license granted shall be revoked by the president, the provisions of this section 3 and 16 hereof shall blah, 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 blah. Nope. During the present war, no enemy. Nope. Whoever during the present war, an opinion of the president. Nope. Don't need that. United States with a successful president may investigate. Wait a minute. Hold on. I think that's the section that I'm looking for. Reasonable cause to believe that any act is about to be performed in violation of Section 3 hereof, he shall have the authority to order the postponement of the performance of such act for a period not exceeding 90 days, pending investigation of the facts by him that the president may investigate, regulate. No, that's the same comment that they put, but I am looking for the national emergency, and I may have to go to the amendment of the act since this is taking me all around the rosies. Pocket full of hosies. Rise, Mary! I'm sorry. Trying to resurrect somebody, huh? That's what that stupid song, that little stupid jingle that children sang. They don't even have any idea what they be singing about. Just be talking about ring around somebody's rosy. Talk about that was when people got ringworm. That ain't had nothing to do with ringworm. If y'all only knew what ring around the rosy was really about. I'm not worried about my account settings. Don't worry about my account settings be out of date. Any person in the United States who holds or has or holds in custody control any property, beneficial or otherwise, alone or joint with others, for or on behalf of the enemy or an ally. Can't be holding nobody else's property who an enemy of the United States, y'all. Just can't do it. Nothing in this act contained shall be rendered valid or legal. Wait. Nothing in this act contained shall render valid or legal, or be construed as recognized as valid or legal any act or transaction constituting trade from what an enemy. Okay. No conveyance and transfer. Nope, not worried about that either. That we can get from the other. Nothing in this act shall be deemed to prevent the payment. Nothing in this act shall be deemed to authorize receipt of notice of the president. Nobody cares about the president. Sorry, nobody does. Ally the enemy, president shall so require any money of other property if repaid, the person shall be held liable, no any payment. Nope, the president shall, come on now. It's messing up again, y'all. See this right up here? I didn't even do that. So put that back up there. Don't know how that got all the way down there. They ain't even supposed to be down there. So put that back up. Okay, we'll straighten that up later. As a matter of fact, what are y'all doing up here anyway? Y'all are not supposed to be up there. Yeah, y'all are not supposed to be all the way up there. I don't know what they were doing up there, sitting up there playing in the rafters. Okay, I know some of y'all are wishing I go on, but again, how many of you knew that they had this much language in the Training with the Enemies Act? Ladies and gentlemen, back then, most of the acts was maybe 15 pages at the most. This, we have gone so far, this is over 2,000 pages. We've gone over 200 pages just on the Trading with the Enemies Act. I've just gone through 200 pages at least with the Trading with the Enemies Act. And we're not even finished. When I say Trading with the Enemies Act, I mean all of the other acts associated with the Trading with the Enemies Act. This is where, when we talk about military occupation, military rule, this is where it started. Okay? It started with the Trading with the Enemies Act. I can't go through the whole thing because that will take too long, but I just want you to know that we have the other statutes at large, the ones that are pertinent to things like the Federal Arbitration Act and the things that were going on at the time. So it started in, what are you doing here, Mayor Wilbites? I didn't ask you to pop up. Get on out of here. Lord have mercy. I don't even know what that was doing there. I didn't even ask for it to show up. Okay, so now that we have that, let's go ahead and show you what we're talking about. And then we're going to move on. So the Trading with the Enemies Act was approved 1917. Cuba. Trump extends Trading with the Enemies Act another year. I want to click on that. How could Trump extend the Trading with the Enemies Act another year when the Trading with the Enemies Act was done in 1917? How could he extend the Trading with the Enemies Act? I thought they said they got rid of the Trading with the Enemies Act when they came up with the National Emergency Act. At least that's what the attorney wrote for the Supreme Court. Huh. And now we have somebody saying that the Trading with the Enemies Act is still going on. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have that. While that's pulling up, let's show you what we've done with this document. I know you were waiting for me to get back to this, and this is for you mortgage people. We have changed a little bit. Conditional acceptance for value and counteroffer, a claim for proof of claim, and tender of payment offering. And we say, please understand the agreement with the original lender. Put the name there. You are presenting us with your name of the party presenting it. New terms. We conditionally accept your offer under the following terms and conditions. Consequently, the remaining question is whether the foreclosure of a mortgage constitutes a debt collection activity. These are the laws that say, yeah, it does! 2018, 2013, 2014. Where's 2014? There it is right there. Okay, and 2015. These are recent, ladies and gentlemen. It is a debt collection activity. Okay, we've had judges say that foreclosure is not a debt collection activity. That is a lie. It has all the elements of a debt collection activity. They even send you a letter. This is an attempt to collect a debt. In California, somebody just read their letter to me this morning saying, this may be an attempt. Well, maybe ain't got nothing to do with it. Okay? You are to provide a complete accounting, signed under penalty of perjury. Then we put the definition for verification. The definition for verification is here twice. The definition for verification is the legal definition. A declaration swearing the statement made in a document are true. Depending upon the jurisdiction, verification are either made under oath or in the presence of a notary public. Okay, the document is online now. All right, we put the code, we put the case law. There you go. Oh, excuse me, I said it again. I'm sorry. I don't mean to be cursing like that, case law. Anyway, coleslaw. All right. However, at the time of the signing of the security agreement, we had no rights in the collateral pledged to secure the loan. Then we put the code there. A security interest attaches when it becomes enforceable against the debtor with respect to the collateral, and attachment occurs as soon as all the other requirements of 9203 of UCC have taken place. Attachments. Ladies and gentlemen, the security can only attach, a security interest attaches to collateral when it becomes enforceable against the debtor. Well, when you did the collateral, you were not a debtor because you hadn't received the loan. You see, initially, I just had, and this is something I told the person today, because the two people signed and one co-signed for the other. So because the individual co-signed for the other, then that was the collateral. The co-signer's signature was the collateral, ladies and gentlemen. That's what a co-signer does. So because that party co-signed, they can't go after him and the home because they did not ask for them to put up the home and the co-signing. It wasn't that type of a deal. They told them, no, well, you're going to need to have a co-signer if you don't have any collateral. You guys have heard that statement. You're going to need to have a co-signer if you don't have any collateral. Former debt dispute qualification, qualified written request. We have combined a debt dispute and a qualified written request in the same document. This is on every single page, so nobody can mistake that we're doing a QWR. The document is up there for free. Some of you guys have knowledge of qualified written requests, but I want you to understand, this is not just a debt correction letter. This is a contract, a conditional acceptance contract with an arbitration clause, but it also has the right of redemption. Now, if you don't know about redemption, look it up, please, people. Common law right of redemption. That's all you got to do is look up. It's called equitable redemption. You have two redemption. You have statutory redemption and equitable redemption. Look them up because this document covers both. What you have to do is you have to find someone who is not you, not the person who is in debt, and you have to give them $10. Just hand them $10. Don't care what happens to the $10 after that. You got to give them $10. The law says you have to give them something of value. So give them something of value. Why? Because value has been given. The debtor has rights to the collateral. So give somebody $10. You are the person signing the contract. So you have rights to the collateral, the home. You're the owner of the home. So give someone $10. And then what you're going to do, it's called equitable redemption. I've already did videos on that too. What you're going to do, ladies and gentlemen, when they come for you, bad boys, bad, anyway, what you're going to do is you're going to understand this section right here. Okay? Under the new law, government obligations is not backed by the credit of the nation. Well, actually, it says it is. I add it not. You know, I should change that, but I'm going to leave it the way it is. I add it not. It does represent a mortgage on all the homes and other properties of all the people of the nation. This is the Senate document, the Senate record, March 9, 1933. This is what they said, that the new money represents a mortgage on all the homes, the Federal Reserve notes. So if the Federal Reserve notes, according to the United States Congress, represents a mortgage on all the homes and other properties of the United States and the people of the nation, what was the original purchase for question for according to the United States? For question number four, sorry, up above. The new deal associated with the new law was for a government obligation. Is this not so? Please note that these are legal questions for which each person is deemed to know the law. And since your business is financial, in a cat's bird seat, respecting the answer to the aforementioned question, and the particulars associated thereto, you should It's supposed to be should have no issues, so I gotta change that. In answering the questions as presented in the context in which they are presented. The first thing I gotta do is, since I said I gotta change that, that means I gotta re-upload this, so this is y'all fault. Look what y'all got me doing. Okay, look what y'all got me doing. Making some corrections already. I don't feel like making no corrections. I told y'all I'm tired. It's after 10 o'clock, people. Okay, maybe you should stop reading it. Please note that it's a legal question. The aforementioned question and in particular is associated there too. You should have no issue in answering the questions as presented in the context in which they are presented. Then we have the obligations of the United States shall not be, and we're going to do the not again. Oh, they got me all tied up in knots, mama. Just all tied up in knots. I mean, I tried to tell them yeses, but they said Nazis. And so I said, okay, I'll be Nazis. I'm not no Nazis, okay? Receivable public dues. That they shall, and we're going to do the bracket again, not be redeemed at the United States Treasury Department or any Federal Reserve Bank. Issuance Federal Reserve notes. You are hereby notified that I do hereby tender payment for the referenced obligation of debt, and I do so in the form of currency cognizable by the United States and backed by my credit, a percentage of rates supported by the value of the intrinsic value of the United States full faith and credit. Like I said, I've been saying this, I didn't add this now, this has already been in the document. I've already proven to you guys that you have a portion, you have an interest in the United States. Okay. PLEDGE. That's what you're going to do. You're going to pledge tender of payment for the reference obligation. Okay? Because you have an interest in the collateral. So you have the right to pledge that interest to offset this debt. Because that interest is cognizable as currency of the United States, your portion of the full faith and credit, they should be able to take that credit to the United States and offset the debt. Shh, don't tell nobody. And because the debt concerns property of the United States, it is deemed by law and operation of statute to be a government obligations. We're going to take our government and we're going to take that and capitalize that in obligations. This is the exact legal phrase. It's government obligation. Uh-oh, that's the wrong. I was thinking yes. And must be handled in accordance with the dictates of statute. I accept the obligation on and in behalf of the United States of America and hereby make an assignment of the obligations to the United States Treasury Department, creating a special relationship on and in behalf of the United States of America as authorized by statute and trust law. Ladies and gentlemen, you must create a special relationship. So that makes this a special relationship contract and trust. You're the grantor. You are to present this item, remittance coupon, to the United States Treasury Department or at any Federal Reserve Bank, including the Federal Reserve member banks, to redeem for the value of the obligation 12401 USC. Guess what? We should put that other code in here, but I'm not going to do that right now because I put it right here. Okay? Directing an immediate credit for the value to my account. Then we say, see this section. Suspension of provisions relating to ally of enemies. Okay, so it was that section, ally of enemy. Regulating transactions of foreign exchange of gold and silver, property transfers, vested interest and enforcement penalties. The president, if he shall find it compatible with the safety of the United States and with the successful prosecution of war, may by proclamation, remember we just read this, during the time of war, now what I put, as a result of the NDAA, the National Defense of America Act, otherwise known as the National Defense of America Act, which as a result of the National Emergencies Act, there is something known as the National Emergencies Act, ladies and gentlemen. National Emergencies Act, like I told you, 1976, enacted. Okay. Which is directly related and associated with the October 6, 1917 Trading with the Enemies Act, which was amended by the March 9, 1933 Act. We're given a history. That's what we do because we ain't got nothing better to do but just talk about history, which President Roosevelt supported by the issuance of presidential proclamation. And let's see, I gotta do the 2039. Okay, that was supposed to be there, and I don't know why I didn't put 2039, so I want to thank y'all, even though y'all getting on my nerves. All right, declaring a national emergency, and I like to do national emergency because those are two very big words. I like to highlight those two big words. Now, I copied and pasted some things. This is basically a copy and pasting. The NDAA requiring the president to continue a war footing, and that's exactly what they did by declaring the NDAA. They required the president to continue a war footing by annually declaring, by annual declaration of war, documenting the full support of the United States Congress, which must be signed by the president at 1 a.m. the first day of every year. President Trump lashes out at GOP after override of veto of the defense bill. This is the guy who wrote it, Matthew Daly, December 29, 2020, General Mountain Time. It says Senator Jim Inhofe, Republican of Oklahoma, arrived at the Senate Republican, arrives at Senate Republicans, and that doesn't make any, arrives at Senate Republican, holds leadership elections on Capitol Hill in Washington, Tuesday, November 10, 2020, Washington, AP, Associated Press. President Donald Trump lashes out at congressional Republicans on Tuesday after the House easily voted to override his veto in a defense policy bill. Defense policy is what they called it. Interesting, ain't it? A total of 109 Republicans, including Wyoming Rep. Liz Cheney and a member of the GOP leadership, joined with Democrats on Monday to approve the override, which would be the first in Donald Trump's presidency. Do you know what? The only time they vetoed Donald Trump's bill, or Donald Trump's, they overrode his veto, is when he was challenging the NDAA to get rid of the national emergency. If he did not sign the NDAA, that would have killed Roosevelt's national emergency and several other national emergencies. We'll talk about that in a minute. The Senate is expected to consider the measure later this week. Trump slammed GOP lawmakers. Slammed them. Dun-dun-dun. Dun-dun-dun. Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. All right. GOP lawmakers on Twitter charging that weak and tired Republican leadership will allow the bad defense bill to pass. How did he get on Twitter? I thought Twitter took him off. He was off of Twitter by December. So how did he do that on Twitter? That don't make no sense. Anyway, Trump called the override of the veto disgraceful act of cowardice and total submission to weak people, to big tech. Negotiate a better bill or get a better leader. Now, the Senate should approve the NDAA until, shouldn't approve the NDAA until fixed. The 322-87 vote in the House sends the override effort to the Senate. While the exact timing of the vote is uncertain, don't have to worry about all of that, okay? The president may, through any agency that he may designate, and under any such rules or regulations he may prescribe, by means of instruction, license, or otherwise, McConnell said on Tuesday that approval of the $740 billion National Defense Authorization Act, we got to do McConnell because I added that. That was actually from an article. Okay, he said the NDAA is crucial to the nation's defense and to deter great power rivals like China and Russia. Well, why? What do you mean? Why did you need the NDAA? I thought you had a military spending bill. You guys don't remember the military spending bill? The NDAA is not the military spending bill, ladies and gentlemen. It's called the National Defense of America Act. It's not a military spending bill. There is already a military spending bill. Shh, don't tell nobody. We won't talk about that. The bill will cement our advantage on the seas and land and in the air and in cyberspace and in space. Yes, Mitch McConnell, thank you for telling us it's going to do everything that it's never done before. Okay, the bill also provides 3% pay raises to United States troops. Improvements on military housing, really? You haven't improved them all this time, so how could that improve them? Child care and more. He brought in children. That's what they do to try to convince the American people that they've done something good when they say they did something for the children. Oh, we did it for the children, Mama. Yeah, that's right. We set up there and we repaved the entire playground. Yes, now it's all cement. No more grass or sand, and so the kids ain't got to worry about getting sand in their eyes or grass stains on their pants anymore. No, the cement is perfect. No more of those injuries. Yes, to make it look like they've done something good. Confirming that we are in a national emergency. Let me make my end, and then we're going to get rid of this video, and then I'm going to do another video right after this, because as tired as I am, I don't want to do this whole video, because we'll be going into 2 hours on one video. President Trump, on March 20th, 2020, made an announcement on national television that the statement, what the statement that these are two very big words, referencing the October 6, 1917 Trading with the Enemy Act and the March 9, 1933 amendment to the aforesaid act, to unleash the full power of the federal government. I am officially declaring a national emergency, Trump said. Two very big words. The authority is in the federal positive law as noted above. Now pay attention. Any payment, conveyance, transfer, assignment, or delivery of property or interest therein made to or for the account of the United States, or as otherwise directed pursuant to this subdivision, and this is what we're pursuing, this subdivision, or any rule, regulation, instruction, or direction issued hereunder, shall, to the extent thereof, be full acquittance, meaning acquittal, no more charging, discharge, no more charging, for all purposes, all purposes, all purposes, all purposes of the obligation. You don't have to use this just for mortgages, ladies and gentlemen. All property in the United States, all property in the United States is the property of the United States, according to the March 19, 1933 Act. Okay? So you can use this for other debts. Anyway, we'll talk, okay? Obligations of person making the same, and no person shall be held liable, no person shall be held liable, no person shall be held liable, even in foreclosure court, in any court, for or in respects to anything done or omitted in good faith in connection with the administration of and the pursuance of and or the reliance on this subdivision or any rule, regulation, instruction, or direction issued hereunder. Ladies and gentlemen, that's why we explained exactly why we're using this, and that's why we say we are relying on this. I want y'all to hear me. That's what this is here for. That's why we added this. Because this says that this should, in all honesty, save your homes. Okay, that's your code right there. That don't look right, so I can't use that one. That one, that's got too many gaps, and I don't want to fall into that. We don't want those type of gaps, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to make it aerial. I like aerial. And you know, it's like this, the seashells and all that. That aerial is all right. Pay attention. Now, therefore, I am relying on Presidential Proclamation 2039 and the federal law known as the Emergency Banking Relief Act of March 9, 1933, In discharging this obligation of the United States, I am further exercising my right of redemption for demanding a full and complete accounting certified, as well as a verified to the precise comprehensive nature of said debt, as provided under my equitable right to redeem my property. There's equitable redemption is not permitted in all territories. So what I'm going to do for you guys is I'm going to say equitable /STATUTORY. You have both an equitable and a statutory right. Okay, so if it's not a equitable right, it's a statutory right in your area to redeem my property. In consideration of the $10 and other goods and valuable consideration in hand paid to, and you name the party you are giving the $10 to, by the undersigned, your name, does hereby grant, bargain, sell, assign, transfer. Let's add one more. We got to add one more. PLEDGE. Pledge and set over onto the former, your friend, all of the latter, yours, right of redemption from foreclosure of that certain mortgage executed by, and you put the name of the mortgage company, okay, and then you put the this is wrong, so we're gonna put, this ain't supposed to be borrower, we were having you put, oh no, the mortgage was executed by you, man, I'm sorry, and the name of the bank on this whatever day it was, together with all other rights, titles, and interests of the borrowers in and to the property. I further transfer and associate equitable rights to the transferee aforementioned in the manner stated aforementioned, and I do so without recourse. Ladies and gentlemen, the one thing you want to do, sorry, I'm putting my hands on my head again because I am dizzy and tired. The one thing that you want to do, ladies and gentlemen, the one thing you want to make sure you do is you don't want to give it to somebody who's not a friend, who's greedy, who will sit up there and kick you out of your own house. You know what I'm saying? You want a friend who's going to work with you. That's why you are assigning the interest to them. Okay? Sorry. I don't know where that G came from. Okay. All right, got that taken care of. I know, told you I'm tired. That's why I didn't see it. And this is per the terms. That's why you're doing a notice of assignment. That's why you're giving a remittance coupon. Don't worry about it, ladies and gentlemen. This is legal tender. Why? Because money orders, all it is an order of money. You're basing it on your credit. Pay attention. Credit by a non-taxpayer at par. By being a non-taxpayer, by being a natural person, ladies and gentlemen, you're using your credit. You're not using the government's credit. You're not using your consumer credit. You're using your actual credit as a living, natural person. Get it straight. Now, once it's understood that you have a right to do this, stand on your square. A judge denies you, then you appeal it, and you bring up all of these points. You don't have to highlight all of these points by bringing up every single paragraph. You mention that you have this right and you put the right. You mention that you have this right and you put the right. Mention that you have a right of redemption, and they never, if they do not provide you that information within the time frame permitted by the so-called statute, and they have a certain amount of days, they must give you a full accounting so that you can pay off the note if you want to. A statement will not do, because you're asking for a verified accounting. Then you're also challenging the debt. So this is a debt collection letter. This letter, this contract is 9 things in one, especially since it has an arbitration clause. Now, as a matter of fact, ladies and gentlemen, we've been having courts say that you can't force somebody to contract with you. That's a lie. You're not forcing nobody to contract. They have an obligation to respond to you. And as long as they have an obligation and you give them an opportunity and you give them an opt-out clause, they must respond. They refuse to respond. They are liable. Stop letting the stupid courts tell you they're not. Okay, we're bringing this to a head. Either they're going to follow the law or they're going to change the law. They only got those two options and nothing else. Again, we bring up verification of debt again. Why? Because verification is defined in the statute. It appears over 6 times in one section. Okay? That is either verified or verification. They must verify, which means they must swear. Declare under penalty that that information is true, not accurate. You have the right under equitable or statutory redemption to receive a full accounting of what is owed on the property. And they have to sign, and they will never sign under penalty of perjury. Why? Because they know that that's not what's owed. And if they lie under penalty of perjury, they die. I mean, they go to jail. Okay? All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is me providing this information. So the QWR is going up. I'm not making any more corrections. Okay, the corrections are what they are. And because I just saved it, I got to do it again. You know, like my Staple Singers. Let's do it again. Let's do it in the morning. Sweet breeze in the summertime. Okay, so now that I have that, we're going to just drag and drop it. Well, I can put it here. I don't have to bring it all the way up there. And I believe nine. No, that's not correct. Yeah, that's not correct. I need to do it again because that's not correct. Because I'm looking at the date on it and that's the wrong date. So let me do it one more time just to make sure that it's the right document, because I made some corrections, y'all saw. And so I want to make sure the right document is up there. Plus, I got to send it to the guy I did the consult with today. Oh, that was putting it in the wrong folder. One second. Okay. I don't know what that is. I apologize for that, ladies and gentlemen. I didn't open this up. What is this? I didn't ask for that. I don't know what this junk is. Bye-bye. Gotta go, gotta go, gotta go. Oh, that was the Trading with the Enemies Act there. Okay, well, where you at, Trading with the Enemies Act? That's not you. You gotta be here. This is it right here. Okay, this is another version of the Trading with the Enemies Act. Okay, and so this is the other one that I've seen. This one, if you notice, ain't no 200 pages long. This is only 29 pages. So I know the Trading with the Enemies Act is longer than this, but 29 pages, that's about, I can live with that, because it's only one section of it. It's not the whole thing. That's what I thought. This is not the whole thing, but I can live with that. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, this is, and let's see if it says what I said it was going to say. And then I'm going to show you what's been going on, because you guys need to know. This, remember, this was 1916. Oh, so this, the Trading with the Enemies Act, the adoption by the courts of a prohibition against trading with the enemy. Nobody asked for that part. I think they're explaining it. And I didn't ask for an explanation. I asked for the actual wording. And yeah, I don't see, be it Congress assembled. Okay, so I don't see what I'm looking for. I think this is just a from a law review. Okay, I thought it was going to be the actual Trading with the Enemies Act, but it appears that it's just a review. That's all it is. Okay, so it's a law review. But we got it, and let's download it before I close the window out. And while we're downloading this junk, I mean, you know, let's see. Trading with the Enemy, REVIEWLAW, Okay. So we got our Trading with the Enemies Act. And I think I'll keep it here. I don't really want it in this folder, but I'll keep it in that folder. All right, that's the Trading with the Enemies Act. Let's get that out of the way. Ladies and gentlemen, to unleash the full power of the federal government, as we told you, Trump continues the Trading with the Enemies Act. Okay? He continues the Trading with the Enemies Act. How does Trump continue an act that was done in 1917? And he said he was doing it for Corona, but he did mention that those were two very big words. Get out of here. Nobody want to talk to you. Okay, this is where I quoted it from. This is the article where Trump announces the National Emergency Declaration at a news conference. National Emergency Declaration. We've already learned that in that new law, well, not new law, it's an old law, that anytime the president makes a declaration of war or a declaration of a national emergency, that he's invoking the Trading with the Enemies Act. He understood that, and that's why he said those are two very big words. I don't care about Miss Pelosi or Donald Trump. They can both go fly a bunch of kites. Ladies and gentlemen, let's see. I'm looking to see. Nah, that's not it. Okay, I can get rid of this too. These are only left up here for you guys. I want to make sure I cover everything. Nope, we don't need this. We're going to go back to this document right here, which I'm going to pull up real quick and want you guys to understand. Oh, by the way, when I said I did the conservatorship earlier today, because the incompetent individual is a creature of the state, I used the Secretary of State's address for that individual. Okay. Anyway, thought I'd mention that. Ladies and gentlemen, any payment or conveyance, transfer, assignment, or delivery of property issued therein, made or on account of the United States, if all property belongs to the United States, is made, if you assign it back to the United States, it's made in the name of the United States. And by the way, the United States can't evict you out of your home. You're one of the people. Or otherwise directed pursuant to the subdivision or any rule, regulation, instruction, or direction issued hereunder shall, to the extent thereof, be a full acquittance. I've been acquitted, Mama. And discharge. Okay, you can go home now. You don't need to stay in this hospital no more. No, get out. No, I don't want to hear it. Get out of my hospital. You're discharged, okay? Sorry. For all purposes of the obligation of the person making the same, and no person shall be held liable in any court for or in respects to anything done or omitted in good faith in connection with the administration of your own property, your own assignment of that debt, or in pursuance of or reliance on this code, this subdivision, or any rule, regulation, or instruction or direction issued hereunder. We're relying on the Trading with the Enemies Act, and I want you guys to go back and read Presidential Proclamation 2039. It says that you're a banking institution. So the president has already given you authority. Okie-me-dokie. All right. With that being said, I think that was the last of the last things that I wanted to show you guys. All right. So with that being said, we're going to let you guys get on what you're getting on. I hope everybody's doing all right. The document is up online. I got to finish sending documents to people. So thank you guys for taking the time to listen to this old man talk to you guys for an hour and 24 minutes about the Trading with the Enemies Act and about how government has set up here and kept us entwined in this military coup that they did in 1917. And the people knew nothing about it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I gotta go. Y'all have a good day. Goodbye. Adios. Arrivederci. Sayonara. I'm out.